When mechanically characterizing biological tissues in vitro, it is essential to create loading conditions that resemble the in vivo loading situation as closely as possible. For quite a number of soft biological tissues, this can be done through planar biaxial tensile testing. This video will guide you through a typical workflow of a planar biaxial tensile test performed at Fiber. We will demonstrate every step for a segment of human ascending thoracic aorta, but the method is applicable to many other tissue types. When resecting the sample from the tissue, it is extremely important to keep track of the exact location of the sample within the tissue, as well as to align the edges of the sample as accurately as possible with the natural axes of the material. For tubular samples, for example, we align the x-axis with the circumferential direction and the y-axis with the axial direction of the vessel. For this type of testing, either cruciform-shaped or square-shaped samples can be used. Since the amount of available tissue is usually scarce, square samples are preferred. Next, a speckle pattern is applied on the top surface of the sample, in this case the luminal side, by using graphite powder. Then, the dimensions of the sample are measured with a micro-laser scanner, using the principle of laser triangulation. The output data is a point cloud of the sample, showing the contour and a thickness map. To attach the sample to the testing device, different mounting mechanisms such as clamps, sutures, or rakes can be used. These all affect the boundary conditions of the test differently, and this must be taken into account when processing the data. When mounting the sample, it's important to align the sample's axes, and hence the axes of the material, with those of the device. Here, we've used a rake-based system, in which the samples are pierced with needle-tip hooks or rakes, with sets of 5 rakes on each edge of the sample. The sample is then immersed in a temperature-controlled fluid bath that's filled with physiological solution at 37 degrees. This to mimic the physiological conditions as closely as possible. During the test, a camera placed perpendicularly to the sample measures the deformation of that sample. This provides more accurate information than using the actuators, because slippage or tear might occur at the mounting site. The sample is then loaded along the 4 edges. The loading protocol can be either force-controlled or displacement-controlled. From a control point of view, force control is more complex because it requires a feedback loop between the force sensors and the actuators. Here we show a typical displacement control loading protocol. The displacement is applied in steps of increasing amplitude, which we call loading levels. Each loading level consists of different loading ratios between both test axes. In a ratio of 1 to 0.5, for example, the amplitude of the x-axis is twice that of the y-axis. We choose to apply those loading ratios or combinations of ratios that are as representative as possible for the in vivo situation. Each loading ratio also consists of different loading cycles to account for the softening effect of the tissue. After a number of these cycles, the behavior of the tissue is repeatable, and this is considered to be the in vivo behavior. The rate of deformation is again chosen to be as representative as possible for the in vivo deformation rate. As an output, we have the displacements of the actuators, the forces at the 4 edges, and images of the camera. Using the principle of digital image correlation, the speckle pattern of the sample is used to calculate the strain present in the sample during the test. Using the initial dimensions obtained with the microlaser scanner, the stress can be calculated from the force measurements. Depending on the application, different options are available for post-processing. We can directly compare the stress-strain curves between sample groups, for example, healthy versus diseased tissue, or we can extract simple or more advanced mechanical properties through parameter fitting of an appropriate material model. These material parameters can then be used in finite element modeling. To summarize, planar biaxial tensile testing of biological tissue involves many aspects, each of which should be performed with care to ensure reliable and repeatable results. At Fiber, we have all the necessary tools and expertise to fulfill these requirements.